Hi, my name is John Tooker. I'm an extension entomologist at Penn State, and we're standing in a soybean field here at the end of July. These soybeans are just about to enter the reproductive stage. They've just started to flower. We're going to scout this field, see if we can find any insect pests. One of my goals as an extension entomologist is to try to work with growers to encourage them to use integrated pest management. And integrated pest management is an approach to assessing insect population in the field, looking for economic damage so we can minimize insecticide use. That is, we want to use insecticides only when it makes economic sense. So we'll walk across this soybean field today, seeing what type of insects are causing the damage, see what types of insect populations are out here to assess whether we have economic damage or not. It may be a surprise to some people but most soybean fields in Pennsylvania do not ever achieve economic damage. There are insect pests in there, there are insects causing damage, but the populations never get big enough to actually force the grower to lose money. Oftentimes, insecticides are applied without necessity. They're just being applied because it makes someone feel better, and they're not actually protecting economic yield. I just pulled this soybean plant out of the ground to illustrate one of the challenges of estimating the amount of defoliation. Soybeans, before the pods are set, can withstand about 25 to 30% defoliation. After the pod's set, it's closer to 15 to 20% defoliation. But it's a challenge to estimate how much defoliation a particular plant has. If you look at that leaf, you might estimate that to be about 15% damage, maybe 10% damage. It's a little bit subjective. How much damage you cause that is, of course, up to you. We could probably scan that leaf and figure out exactly how much damage there is there, but we want to do this in the field kind of on the fly. There's a tendency to overestimate the amount of damage on a plant, so while I might call that 15% damage, it's more likely closer to 10. When we're talking about a whole plant defoliation, though, we're not talking about individual leaves, we're talking about how much leaf material has been removed from an entire plant. This plant seems to have a lot of damage. You can see that leaf, this leaf has some holes in it, but I think on balance, the great majority of the leaves have little to no damage. So as you're assessing the whole plant, you have to take all the leaves into consideration. So if I had to ballpark this, I'd call that maybe somewhere between 5 and 10%. Okay? My 5 and 10% might be different than your 5 and 10%, but what you want to do is get a good representation of the amount of damage you're seeing and not just rely on what you're comfortable with, right? Because when we're using IPM, we're not using comfort zones, we're using actual measured loss of yield. And remember, it's not just an individual plant. If this one plant is, say, 50% defoliated, but the rest of the plants in the field look fine, then you have a non-economic concern. It's kind of the average damage across the entire field. So the first species we found here is actually a fairly charismatic species. This is the silver spotted skipper. It's a caterpillar of the silver spotted skipper butterfly. And it's an occasional pest of soybeans. It's kind of a pretty little guy with a bright red head with orange dots on it and this nice striped yellow body. And they're kind of fun, but they rarely cause economic damage. What they will do is they tend to fold leaves. If I can put that down. They tend to fold leaves and then they chew on the leaves, causing obvious chewing damage. So this is damage caused by this guy. You can see perhaps in the camera here that this was folded over. This is kind of a leaf roll. They kind of hide inside the leaf roll, and if you pop that open, the caterpillar will be sitting right there. This individual is pretty large, has to be in one of its last developmental stages, will probably pupate on its way to becoming an adult soon. So that's the velvet bean caterpillar. The velvet bean caterpillar causes this type of damage on leaves. Also can feed from the edge, but they're easy to diagnose because they have a very distinctive behavior. When you bother a velvet bean caterpillar, they wiggle like crazy. Of course, they're not going to do it on camera. See if, can you get that? Wiggle. Ah! Did you see it? Wiggle, man. Oop! See that? Did you get that? That's awesome. So this is the velvet bean caterpillar again, and it causes defoliation, but just like the other caterpillar I mentioned, soybeans can withstand a lot of damage from these guys. So an economic spray wouldn't be necessary until you're at 15% defoliation when you have pods present, or closer to 30% defoliation when the pods aren't present. But they're not that common in most fields, but sometimes you'll see a couple per plant, and that's when you really start to notice their damage. But again, because a soybean plant can withstand so much defoliation, they're rarely an economic concern. Occasionally, but rarely. So another pest species that we're finding out here in the field today is something called soybean aphid. Soybean aphid are awfully small little yellow dots on the underside of leaves. They tend to prefer to colonize the really young leaves, so the foliage at the top of the plant. Then they slowly spread across the plant. Soybean aphids can be awfully damaging if they get to really big populations. In fields like this, though, where we haven't used insecticides, lady beetles and other predatory insects do a great job of holding back soybean aphid populations. For a while in Pennsylvania, we had a two-year cycle where we had low aphid populations and big aphid populations. The last year we had really big aphid numbers in Pennsylvania was 2009. Since then, the population has been awfully low and they haven't been an economic concern. So they're certainly here, and growers can be nervous that they're in their fields, but as long as you use IPM and scout and look for the pest, you can determine whether they're a problem for you or not. So everyone's familiar with stink bugs these days because of the brown marmorated stink bug. This happens to be a good stink bug, and a good stink bug is one that's a predator. So this is something called the spined soldier bug, and it's a beneficial insect. It prowls around crop fields, like this soybean field, and eats soft-bodied insects. So you can see this one here has a caterpillar on the end of its beak, on the end of its mouth part, and that caterpillar is pretty much done causing any damage to this soybean field. So one way that integrated pest management is beneficial is we avoid insecticidal sprays unless they're absolutely necessary, because we're trying to maintain populations of these good insects that can kill the pests that are trying to feed upon the field. So this caterpillar likely caused some damage that looked like that, and because that stink bug has now killed that, sorry, caterpillar, that damage is stopped, and a grower doesn't have to worry about that particular caterpillar anymore, right? And soybeans are a great place for that to happen because of how closed the canopy is. There's a lot of good kind of microenvironments down there for natural enemies to live, and they'll help protect your fields. So here we have Japanese beetle. We have four individuals feeding, and this kind of lacy damage is very distinctive of Japanese beetle. Japanese beetles tend to aggregate like this because while they're feeding, an odor is emanated from the plant, and that odor attracts other individuals, and they kind of group together like this. You can see they can mate if they all get together. They can also kind of feed all together. And if you can see other places in this field, we have the very distinctive kind of lacy damage attributable to Japanese beetle. But again, because soybean is so good at tolerating damage, this is a low level of damage, it's not an economic concern. That's called a syrphid fly or a hover fly. And adults are very common floral visitors, but the larvae of that thing are aphid feeders. So I showed you soybean aphid earlier. The maggot of this fly will wander around soybean plants looking for soft-bodied insects to feed upon. And they'll often find aphids, and that would be a wonderful treat for them. Look, we've got a couple of them flying around here. The next pest species that we've run across here in our soybean field is the bean leaf beetle. This is the adult of the bean leaf beetle, and he causes this type of damage, causing little holes in the leaves. It's not quite the same as Japanese beetle damage, which is more lacy type damage, but these little holes, they can add up. One challenging thing about bean leaf beetle is they can come in a variety of colors. So this is a yellow one with black dots. There are also red ones with black dots. But the key is this little triangle kind of right after their neck. So that neck is what I'd call their thorax. Right behind their thorax is a little V triangle, black triangle. That is always there, whether it's a red one or a yellow one like this. But it's all bean leaf beetle, and rarely do they cause economic damage this time of year. So again, we're at the end of July. They can cause more of an economic concern in the spring when soybeans are just emerging from the ground and they are attacking the cotyledon stage soybeans. So they have two generations a year. But this time of year, it's not a huge concern. The one exception to that would be if they're feeding on the pods. This field, the soybean pods have yet to form, but if you have large populations of bean leaf beetle feeding on pods, and there's a lot of pod damage, then you have an economic problem that would require treatment. But prior to the pod formation, they're just causing this kind of cosmetic leaf damage, it's of no great concern. So one of the more common insect species that we've been able to find here in this soybean field today are grasshoppers. We have adult grasshoppers, we have nymph grasshoppers, and they appear to be fairly common. Grasshoppers like this, though, are rarely economically damaging in Pennsylvania soybeans. They're more problematic in the Great Plains or even on the eastern shore of Maryland and Virginia, where for some reason grasshopper populations can just go wild. But here in central Pennsylvania, they're not that big of a deal. You see them hopping around a lot, you see them causing a little bit of damage, but again, they never really cause that 30% defoliation that would be relevant for economic control in soybeans. So we've spent a fair amount of time in this soybean field today looking for insect pests. And not surprisingly to me, we haven't found that many. Again, most soybean fields aren't beset by insect problems. Just occasional fields are pretty well infested. So the key to controlling insect pests effectively in this type of field is to getting out there and scouting to see what's out. Seeing what's causing the damage is key to understanding what needs to be controlled. So today we found bean leaf beetle, we found silver-spotted skippers, we found Japanese beetles, we found a couple caterpillar species besides the silver-spotted skipper, and they're all causing relatively low amounts of damage. The main pest I would be concerned about in this field would be soybean aphid. Soybean aphid populations can grow awfully fast, but if you have a good population of natural enemies, that's going to substantially slow their growth, even stop their growth. So I would recommend not doing anything with this field, that is not applying any insecticides, coming back in 2 weeks, scouting it again, seeing how the pest population looks like, and it's likely that this field would get through all the way to harvest without needing an insecticide application. And again, that seems to be the case for the great majority of soybean fields in Pennsylvania. They're out there growing effectively, and they're not being dogged that much by insect pest populations. All right, well, so thanks for joining us today as I scouted this soybean field. If you have any questions, check the website listed below.